is actually you are talking about a huge training potential is required for this kind of digital process. So we have that in writing. Can we have that in your voice? Can you tell us something more on that in your voice?
About the education. Well, I think that the important thing is a kind of this multidisciplinarity. If you are a specialized, for example, medical doctor or whatever, then you understand something about technology, but how to use it and how to have the best solutions to support your work. I think there you need to have more knowledge and connections with universities or enterprises, because enterprises, industry has also quite nice education materials. And of course, when you have these new tools in your work, then you have to consider all the time how to make the maintenance, so that if something goes wrong, is there a backup system or what happens then? And I think that is a kind of learning process, but also training and rehearsing, experiencing, because you know what happens and how to deal with, and that's why it's a learning process. And also how to have the qualified data. Now, if you have this structured data, you understand ICD-10 or whatever, then it's quite easier than if you have information collected which is not structured. So there are kind of, if it's possible to have this documented, precisely documented information, I think it's today it is quite safe to then continue analyzing that. But if you don't have using for social media, and you can collect information, then it's a little bit challenging, and it needs to understand what happens. And also, there's ethical issues and security issues. I think that especially in Finland and in European Union, we have very strict data regulation. Data regulations and guidelines, how to proceed and how to use the data and I think this is all about learning how to do that and then how to apply the best solutions to support one's work. And also when you work in an organization, there's an administration who needs to have information about your work and what happens there, and they can guide or conduct your work and it's a big kind of learning process. And in Finland, I think in less resource country, it's not so common that the patients provide information, but in the Western and especially in Nordic countries, we are in the situation that we have national archiving system, and then now the patients will create their own data quite soon. So we are proceeding that way. And I think that in less resource countries, it is better when you don't do all these expensive phases as we have done here. You can jump to the modern and less expensive tools. And I think that especially when you learn to use these tools as part of your work, then you have this cooperation with other professionals, with your peers. For example, you can get the information about the recent studies and you can compare, and I think it's a kind of world is open when you know how to use, and if you have tools to use them around the world if you have colleagues there. And so I think I am a teacher, so I think that the learning process is very important.
The whole gamut of digital technology you have so nicely given in your answers, that has really impressed us a lot, to be very frank. It's no joke, it's no exaggeration. In this way, we have also learned a lot through your answers. But if we are talking about introducing digital technology, certainly that will involve huge costs. You have to train a lot of people, and you have to really have specialists around, because only buying the machinery or equipment that alone will not have. Like you said just now, you need a backup system for that too. So, that is actually the thing which we'll keep in mind too. And I think you are going to talk about all these things rather elaborately during the conference, in the ICEHAT here in Kathmandu.
Yeah, I think that, and especially, I don't know how it's in your legislation, but in European Union, they launched in May, late May, a new regulations, and it touches all European Union countries. And as I said, I have to all the time study more and more and more. And if you have some wishes for my presentation, please send me in advance so I can be prepared. Because they are, as I said, it's so wide and it's a huge area, and you have to just pick. You can't tell everything you know. You just have to pick some, focus some, and then maybe some more detail.
Yeah, certainly, we will not say, we'll not blame you, Dr. Kouri, that you have come up with such a brilliant idea and the offers and the suggestions in the system. We are not going to put you in jail or behind bars for that. We will certainly welcome you with garlands, with flowers, and so on. Now, Dr. Kouri, you were talking about the Africa model. You are in Africa, and in Africa you had those experiences. Could you tell us a little bit more on that?
Yes, we made a kind of trial. We had a village in the Pirkko Kouri, I don't know how they pronounce it, and then we collaborate with the village chief, and then we educated, I think there were a group of 10 of those community health workers, so we provided them with video cameras, and also there was a kind of internet station which was provided during the project. And then there were, from Finland, there were different professionals, and they were teaching also how to use the tools. And then they were recorded. They went from house to house, or to from the place people were living. They went there and asked about questions related to maternity, mother-child care, about the safe environment, and how breastfeeding is important instead of using bottle, because there's no fresh water available sometimes, so it's easier to breastfeed then. And then they were teaching in collaboration with the local community health workers. They were teaching mothers, and also there's a challenge because the male, sometimes the mother couldn't answer anything because the man, the cultural issue, the man wanted to have the word. So you had to kind of, how to say, be in a very sensitive way to be there and work. And I think that, and then I think we reported that because it was over 10 years ago. But anyhow, it was new at that, those living lab systems. So we kind of built a living lab system in the local village. And then, for example, there were some, like the questions, are oranges dangerous for the pregnant woman, and something like that, which is based on ignorance. So they could, when they had those community health workers had more information, and they could have they could show what the answers those families or the said, and also they videotape the environment so that it would be more safe and more clean for the newborn baby. And so it's a kind of that kind of work we did there, and the village chief of the village came to Finland with one community health worker, and then we went to the Africa and it was kind of that kind of system we tried there. And actually, I have not been involved since the first trial, but when we discussed the actually, it was not a lack of how to use the tools. When you don't have not too complicated but still effective ones, I think that it in that village it worked well.
Yes, I mean, thank you for the detailed answer on that. So Africa is a very vast country, and plus there are so many restrictions, like for example language impediments, understanding, etc. But at the same time, Dr. Kouri, I mean, you were talking earlier about the integration of digital technology in the net system, for example, one country to the other, easily connected. Whereas in Nepal, it's happening this way, let me tell you, that some hospitals have got a mini system of digital technology within their house, within their system, but so far as coordinating in the form of a network is not there. So I think, like you have suggested, it would be worthwhile to have all these people, all this technology inside one net so that people can coordinate with each other. So this is the system. And when you come to Nepal in November, you will know more on that. So allow me to, please.
And actually I was, because in Finland we have had now this national archiving system, and also all our recipes, medical recipe, medication, they are in electronic format, but it took over 15 years to build that, even in Finland. So it's not, but now we have this national archiving system, and all Finns are part of that, and also our medical doctors and private, public and private ones are, but it took time, and I hope that not in your country it does take so much time but and energy as we have done it in Finland, because we had 1986 our very first strategy for how to use technology as part of healthcare. So we have come a long way.
Yeah, that's true. Look, a developed country like yours, it took also so many years to come into that form, into that system, whereas a country like Nepal will take really many years. I mean, but still, for an institution or medical institution like DISHARC, I think DISHARC can also profit a lot, can be an initiator, can be an exponent, a pioneer of this kind of technology in the integrated form, not single unit, but together, one hospital connected with the other and so on. Now, again, now we got this, and you have talked so well about having a very reliable infrastructure. Could you tell us something about this?
Well, I think that in Finland, we have done it so that our, I think there are three ministries included in the system, because we have the Ministry of Treasury, then we have this the Ministry of Traffic and Telecommunications and Social and Healthcare. They have been collaborating together. So one part is done by the different ministries, and then we have joint projects, national projects. They are joint. So we have split the work. This work is done by this part, this one, this, and our Prime Minister is now from the engineering background, and she's from ICT. And he has built now 9 principles so around the digitalization. So we are not just one special field like healthcare. We have social and healthcare, then our other branches, and they are collaborative. So we have these reliable networks, and we are building all the time, because there are more technological requirements so that the data doesn't get stuck. So the data moves better. So we have, it is not just, it is a kind of the whole nation is behind that. So we have different ministries, and then we have this standards, technological standards, like the Kanta. Kanta is our national archiving system, and it has a kind of technological solutions which are well accepted, and so the integration could be built. And then there's the education element. Then there are the processes, how to do that. So it's in many level which we have done. And I think that it helps when you see the whole picture and the multidisciplinarity, and everybody brings their expertise to build this system. And that's why I think that it works. But it has done, as I said, a lot of money and a lot of time. But now it is quite well working throughout the country, and even in abroad, if you if I'm in Spain, I can check my lab values because of this, I can access to my healthcare data.
So that's a very good point you have mentioned. And one thing which really struck me, well, right, positively, no negative, positively, is the fact when we talk about this digital technology, whether it will work among people with a poor literacy rate or so, but you have now already countered that. You had said that you can use photos, drawings, paintings, and possible animations to explain to them. Can you tell us a little bit more on that? What more can we do?
Do you mean that from the side of the professionals or in collaboration with professionals and ordinary people, illiterate people? Because then if you can show, for example, we had drawings from the how the womb grows when we are pregnant and how what happens when if you breastfeed. I am discussing about the mother-child healthcare. So we could show how what happens and maybe mark this is not a good way to do and then if you can if you can't write but you can talk then you can use your voice and so I think there are a lot of possibilities depending what are the means or tools you are using and what kind of applications you have there. So that are you collecting information, are you educating or are you sending information? There are a lot of possibilities. And you, I think you should use more than not just written text, but to illustrate. So we had in our maternity infant clinic on the net project, we had drawings, then we had some animations, for example, how to give birth. Now, I think it's ordinary. You can find a lot of material in that in today's internet. And then we had these photos, realistic photos. So there are a lot of because videos are quite expensive to make in different languages. They are still quite expensive, but I think they're getting cheaper because the technology is coming better and cheaper.
Wonderful talking to you, Dr. Kouri. Now I'm coming to, to the end of our discussions or interview, and I'd like to just ask you, I'll just inform you a little bit, regarding the telehealth and telemedicine in Kathmandu organized by DIHARC from time to time. I've taken part also in telehealth and e-medicine, and then I've been there to the villages and so on. DIHARC is doing, well, a great job in that. Although I'm not a doctor, I'm just from the media person, media section. I'm just a journalist. Yeah. Officer. So I've come across people, I've spoken to them, and they have given me very good feedback regarding DIHARC's activities over there. And you're coming to Kathmandu, Dr. Kouri.
Yes,
we are really excited to receive you over here. How excited
Thank
are
you.
You?
Actually, I'm pretty excited. I had never been there. I have been many times in Africa and in China and even Brazil, but never in Kathmandu. So Nepal. So I'm very excited. I've heard a lot about and a kind of challenges because you have mountains and your infrastructure is totally different than ours. So I'm really interested and open mind. I have an open mind. I have no resources or whatever. I am very open.
Yeah, people are also different over here. And certainly Nepalese people do respect other people. We don't say our people are the best and other people from other countries are worse. No, we love people from all over the world. So through this Zoom interview, I would like to extend a good invitation on behalf of SHARC that you
Thank
come
you.
To Kathmandu. We shall meet, we shall talk, and we can exchange ideas. Thank you very much, Dr. Kouri.
Thank you so much.